guys.
Good morning.
Yes.
Wow. Oh, this is great.
Four or five hours.
Oh, yeah.
Good 4 or 5 hours at 70 miles an hour.
Did you go to Pittsburgh first?
Everywhere in the plane.
Gotcha.
From Jersey, it took like 4.5 hours to get the whole mountain.
Hey, I'm Kevin. This is Bob. We took a ride up yesterday to see Jack Rich's collection. We stayed overnight and met up with some more of the guys, volunteers from the museum. And we're checking out the museum. Mark Leshevsky was kind enough to show us around, give us a wonderful tour. And the cars here are astonishing. Right, Bob?
I agree, and I think this would be like one of my favorites. I like the hardtop version, and I like the convertible version. And nice and shiny.
We told Mark we're going to leave Bob here. Bob could work his heart out.
Right.
Shine like crazy in this place. And everything here is amazing.
Nothing to do. It's all shined up already.
Mark Leshevsky, if you don't know who I am.
And welcome. Glad to have everybody here. As opposed to what you're working with, we're a private collection. We're not open to the public. So we don't have a lot of good volunteers like yourself. There's three of us here, including myself, that work here full time. If you want, I'll walk around and give you a walking tour of some of the key cars in the collection. I won't talk about every one of them. And I'll let you guys mull around if you want.
So we've got we don't have a theme per se, other than the fact that we pretty much buy what we like.
That's a good theme.
Go rubbing your nose.
You know, like Fred's more focused on a certain specialty, and a lot of guys focus on more of Packards or whatever. So there's really no discrimination here, whether it's Dodge or Duesenberg, Ford or Ferrari. They're all here because that's what Jack enjoys. You can see the car alongside is an 06 National built in Indianapolis. These are very high-end cars. It's the first year you could buy a six-cylinder American car. A number of car companies debuted the six-cylinder in 06. This one, I think, is 477 cubic inches, or cast in singles. Body's cast aluminum from firewall back. This particular car was owned by a gentleman by the name of Death Valley Scotty. And in the Wild West folklore, in the Wild West folklore, Scotty was known as the fastest con in the West. He was a notorious flim-flam man, and when you go to Death Valley, there's a castle there named Scotty's Castle. And that's because he bamboozled some Chicago tycoon into believing that there was gold in Death Valley, and he and his wife moved there. And originally in 06, the Nationals had a round radiator, and it wasn't until 08 that the shield style was introduced, and you could have the option of either two. The car was brought back to the Los Angeles distributor and updated with this new front end. After they stopped using this car, Scotty sold it to the Santa Fe Railroad, and they used it as a stagecoach to go from the railroad stations to the little desert mining towns. So that's why you see the big spotlight on there. Because, you need a pilot and a co-pilot to traverse all the little desert trails. Cylinder, 3.5 liter push rod overhead valve with triple Solex carburetors on it and a Cotel gearbox. The chassis is pretty much identical to what they were using pre-war. They just transferred it over to the post-war with a little bit, modern post-war styling.
Was this a competition car?
It is. Yeah, it's the 135 N. What's that?
Oh, the 135M?
Yeah.
That's the sporting chassis?
Yeah. Yeah, so it's got the triple carbs and the hotel as opposed to the single carb. I don't believe it's an MS. Judging by the serial number on the engine, I don't think it's an S, but it's still, the upper echelon. This is the 31 Avions Voisin. It's a C20 Berlin. It's a V12 sleeve valve engine. They made, Voisin made about 30 or 40 V12 cars on three different chassis. This is the underslung chassis, which was used for competitions and such. Voisin really wasn't into racing as much as he was for endurance world record setting, so they did a lot of high speed runs for 12 hours and 24 hours, etc. to prove his car. So it's a unique car. The doors are friction fit. They have this really weird design. I mean, the door handles like they came out of a Philco refrigerator, but there's a series of pegs that fit in there, and there's really not much of a door latch, so they sort of, when it fits together and the car's moving, it sort of tightens against itself. Custom coach built cars, a lot of the Duesenbergs and the like were pretty much all custom coach built. Mercedes was really the exception to the rule. Most of the cars were single fin and body cars. This is one of the rare ones that were not. I think they only made, only 16 540Ks were actually bodied outside the factory. This one was sent to Stockholm for a very prominent Stockholm citizen, and it was bodied by Norrmalms, a little known Stockholm company. I think there's only four Norrmalm cars left. The company burned down in 48, but there's a V12 Packard, a Volvo, and I believe a Buick out there. But this was made for a gentleman by the name of Max Gumpel, who earlier in life was a gold medalist in swimming, I believe, for Sweden, but was listed as a master builder, which is, I guess a fancy word for saying contractor, but he was really much more than that. He had a lot of pull in the government. If you look at this license plate, it's A54. A signifies the capital city, which is Stockholm, and 54 is a very low number. The little buggy is it's the last horse-drawn mail carrier in the state of Pennsylvania, if you know how to leave Leighton. The car I'm standing in front of is a 1988 Attal Design Aztec concept car. Attal Design, was founded by Giorgetto Giugiaro, who did a lot of the great early Maseratis when he worked at Bertone, and is also responsible for things like the DeLorean and even commonplace cars such as the Volkswagen Sciroccos and VW Golfs and stuff like that. But Giugiaro was pretty much the father of the fingertip controls that you see on today's cars. He wanted to make things very user-friendly, and even a lot of his earlier designs, like the Isuzu Impulse and the Subaru XT, were one of the very first production cars that had a lot of fingertip controls on the steering wheel. And this was, like most Kent's concept cars, a look into the future of what could be. You're just basically pushing the envelope, and very rarely do you ever see a concept car go into production. And this car was an idea of what could be in the future with fingertip controls. If you look at the side panel on this car, the idea was that you could push a series of key codes to activate certain things on there. And that was never put into production. But even like some of the Fords that had a key code on the door to get in, obviously it went into that area. Thank you. essentially you've got a, and this is a dual fuel car, and it'll run on both petrol and coal gas. On this side, you've got your pot-bellied stove and your hopper, which you would just fill up with here, you know, fill your charcoal or wood or coal. And, you know, you've got your pot-bellied stove on that side that you would light like you would for a house. And then after you got the fire going, whether it took a half an hour or whatever, then you've got this filtration system here as well. And that would keep a lot of the soot out of the car. Underneath the hood is a split carburetor. You've got a petrol carburetor and you've got a vapor carburetor. And you've got a, it's probably easiest for me to open the hood and show you. After you've got your fire cooking on the other side, what you would do is you'd hot wire this fan to the battery, and that would draw all the combustible gases up through this filtration system. After about 10 minutes of doing that, you stand up to the side with a match and hold it here. look for a flame with a pink tinge. once you got that flame, you know you were good to go. So you could shut off. If you were lucky enough, you had gasoline, you could shut off the petrol carburetor on and open up the vapor carburetor. It's not efficient whatsoever. It's probably only 30% the efficiency of gasoline. But if you don't have a choice, it beats walking. You know, I've seen motorcycles that were converted over that had a little bitty stove and a filter on one side. I mean, so you know if there wasn't any fuel to power a motorcycle that gets 150 miles per gallon, you know, there wasn't any fuel at all. You know, if you look at a lot of the World War II photographs of the German fleet, you know, or the German troops, you'll see a big truck carrying firewood. And that's because they had their vehicles converted over. So this, you know, there was a vehicle that was just, you know, transporting firewood and stuff for their vehicles. Yeah. But you know, a lot. I mean, this one was a kit, but I've seen a lot of these things that were converted over that looked very post-apocalyptic with these huge furnaces sticking out of the trunk and, you know, very road warrior style type of stuff. You know, I've got pictures of these cars with a huge balloon on top filled with acetylene gas. So,
is this your everyday driver?
No, no. You know, does this car work on both fuels? Yes. Do I? No. I like my eyebrows.
Right. You said you have your eyebrows.
This is our Type 38 Bugatti, 38A, I'm sorry. So it's a supercharged 2-liter straight A, 3 valves per cylinder, overhead cam. It wasn't one of their best cars. It was sort of the stopgap in between the 35 and the 43. But you know, grand sport body with four passenger seating and a convertible top, basically because, you know, during a lot of the racing eras, especially Le Mans, they had to follow that configuration. And even in a couple of years during Le Mans, you had to stop at some point in time in the race and drive with the top up. So, which was, you know, just the bizarre ACO regulations at the time.
It's
right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Turbocharger, they call them the. Yeah, turbocharger they call it a wastegate. Supercharger they call it a pop up or blow off.
Okay.
Oh, that's pretty.
Wow. So,
that's beautiful.
Yeah, and you know, the Bugatti family, even before they built cars, were a family of artisans. You know, whether they did furniture, or sculpture, or jewelry, and you know, everything that they designed, they treated as sculpture. You know, someone once told me that there's a thesis out there, and I haven't found it yet, but that the interior of the engines were designed after the Parthenon in Greece. And it, you know, it's very possible. I don't know. I know that, you know, they did design their own nuts and bolts with a square bolt and a hex nut, because, you know, from an engineering standpoint, you're supposed to hold the nut, or supposed to hold the bolt and tighten the nut. So, but and then of course it's got the notorious awful cable brakes, which, you know, there's a lot of running jokes about that. And of course, you know, the great story, whether it's true or not, is that somebody brought back a Bugatti to the factory to Mr. Bugatti and claimed about the brakes that the car wouldn't stop, and his response was, you know, I make my cars to go, not to stop. So whether or not that's true or just urban legend, it's hard to say. So. This car is a, you know, a 48 Delahaye. It's another 135M. This is bodied by Fagoni and Falashi, which is the same people that did the Teardrop Coupe. They did about 18 of this series of car, and 9 are left in the world. You know, it's essentially, it's the same, it's the exact same chassis as the 49 over there. They're almost the exact same chassis as the pre-war cars, which were, you know, great Grand Prix cars. You know, it's almost identical to the one that you have in the collection. This, you know, 3.5 liter, this has got the Kotel gearbox on them, and, you know, they're very, very powerful for this day. You know, like a woman going to a fancy ball with a gown, she wouldn't want to see somebody else walking with the same one. So they didn't do two cars alike, and most of the time they had, you know, slightly different bumpers, slightly different chrome treatments, different headlight placements, fog light treatments, you know, taillights, whatever. Just enough different touches to set them apart from the other cars in the series. I mean, if you go and watch the movie To Catch a Thief with Cary Grant and Grace Kelly, in the very opening scenes, you'll see a sister car in this. It's just slightly different than this car.